585 in your hymn book, count your many blessings.
When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings and them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord.
Spend all day long counting my blessings. Y'all can be seated. 584 in your hymn book, coming to his presence.
Coming to his presence, with thanksgiving in your heart, and give him praise, and give him praise. Coming to his presence, with thanksgiving in His grace, the voice is raised, give glory and honor and power. deep and boundless peace. To this I owe, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can see all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. To this I hope, my Shepherd will defend me. Through the deepest valley He will lead. Oh, the night has been won, and I shall overcome, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The price it has been paid, for Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated. Jesus now and ever is my plea. Chains are released, I can sing, I am free, yet not I, but through Christ in me. With every breath, I long to follow Jesus, for He has said that He will bring me home. And day by day, I know He will renew me, until I stand with joy before the throne. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus.
It's important that we realize that it is in Christ alone that we're able to carry out the kingdom's work in His ministry. I know the children, as they're leaving, I know it's time for children's church for them, and y'all just make your way on back. That'll be fine. And as they're leaving, and I do want to also make mention, and many of you know we're a little bit low this morning, not only because of a holiday, but because of our youth group. It's up in the mountains, and they'll be traveling back. And I think we had a total of around, with the adults and youth, it was somewhere around 17 or 18 that left. And so they had a good retreat, and I hope things go well with them. I know it was a new event for Alex as well, for them going up there. And so, but it seemed like things are beginning to go well with their youth group as a new director. And so we pray that things will go well with them. But I want to thank you for being here in the Lord's house this morning as we worship Him and as we sing praises unto Him. This morning, I'm going to be preaching a message entitled, Be Thankful That God Is With Us. Are you glad that God is with you? I don't know about you, but I am so glad that God is with me, because in the journey of life, it's so important to be able to know that God is present and that He has not forsaken us and He has come to dwell among us. And so we're going to be talking about the fact that we need to be thankful that God is with us this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer, okay? Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so thankful that you have loved us and that you have truly blessed us in all the amazing ways that you have demonstrated your love and your faithfulness towards us. Father, I just pray now that you'll take these few moments of the proclamation of your holy word and use it to honor, to glorify you, and to encourage others. Father, I surrender this message unto you, and may I say those things again that need to be said, but yet those things, Father, that will honor you and that will be a blessing to your people. Father, we just thank you for the privilege of being able to come and to worship you and to be able to make your word applicable in our lives. I pray that you'll bless these few remaining moments that we have in this worship service this day, in Jesus Christ's name, amen. Before we look at the text this morning, I just want to make some general introductory comments leading up to what we're going to be looking at actually this morning. But the thing that's amazing is that Thanksgiving is upon us. Amen? It's here, okay? The time has come. Many turkeys have given of their lives for today, okay? But, Thanksgiving here, and people are going to be thinking about, what's going to be going on Black Friday or Friday. Everybody's going out and doing stuff and buying gifts and things like of that nature. And so for Christmas, but I enjoy the Thanksgiving season. I've told people this many a times. I feel that Thanksgiving gets robbed. I do. Now, I'm a big Christmas person, but let me tell you something, folks. Thanksgiving is important also, because we need to be mindful. We need to be thankful of everything that we have in life's journey. I believe that we need to have a thankful spirit all year long. And when we come to Thanksgiving, let's just be thankful. That's what it was all about. That's what it began with. Do you know that our early forefathers, they were very thankful because of God's providential care. His providential care during some very troublesome times as we began this great nation. And I really think we need to emphasize this more, because I believe there's a lot of people in America today that just feels like that everything that we've got, it just fell out of the sky somewhere. And we forget to be so thankful for what we have each and every day, y'all. Have you ever thought about this? You go out and you get in the car and you go down the road. That car didn't just fall out of heaven somewhere. It goes all the way back to the Industrial Revolution, all the way back to the fact of Ford, Henry. It goes way back. And you know what else? You didn't just get this thing out of nowhere. Correct? Come on, y'all. And you know what else? There are so many things. A lot of times we don't even think about the food that we eat. Some people reckon think that cows fall out of the sky somewhere. Eggs just seem to show up on the grocery shelf, Milk just shows up in the refrigerator somehow. It just happens to be there, So what we've got to realize is we are so, so blessed in America. May we just be thankful for what God has given us, and let's be thankful for our forefathers who put the time and the effort into the establishment of this great nation. Do you know that in 1621 basically was the first time that they had a successful harvest celebration, our early forefathers? And the colonist days, they begin to do that. And as they begin to do that, their Thanksgiving was not just a one-time shot over at mom and dad's house. Okay, you know what I'm saying? It wasn't that. It was a three-day celebration. Okay? And in the three-day celebration, there was a couple of things that happened that sound, when I read some history on this, I said, they must have been Tennessee rednecks. That's the only thing I can figure out, okay? In the early beginnings at this first meeting in 1621, they shot rifles and cannons. Boy, it was a big celebration. Boy, wouldn't it be something if we just decided that we were going to shoot a bunch of rifles for some fireworks show and just let loose with a couple of cannons across this valley over here? We'd have more squad cars than you've ever seen in your life show up here. But you know, that was the beginning of this great nation. And as we begin to celebrate, our early forefathers had a spirit of thanksgiving. But it wasn't until 1863 when President Abraham Lincoln declared Thanksgiving as a national holiday. It's an older holiday within our nation, and it came about in 1863. But you know, as we've progressed along the way through history, may we be thankful this week for the opportunity that we have had to experience this great nation and be thankful for God's extended favor upon us as a nation. And may we be thankful for God's extended favor upon our families and upon our individual lives. We have so much to be thankful for. And I pray that we'll have a very thankful spirit as we persevere through this week. This morning, what I would like for us to do is I want us to continue from last week's message out of Psalm 1. And so last week in Psalm 1, I basically just dealt with verses 1 and 2. And I thought it was very appropriate because I kind of said, you know, Thanksgiving is coming. So what we're going to do is we're going to move on down into verses 3 and 4, where we're going to be talking this morning about how we need to be thankful to God that he is with us in this journey. Might we notice some very important things in regard to that and how that we need to be thankful as we walk through life's journey. One of the first things I want you to notice in verse 3 is the writer here says this. He says, and he, this individual, is thankful because he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Do you know something that's very, very important for us to understand? That's so vitally important is, might we be thankful today for God's providence in our lives? Because some of you are saying, well, what do you mean by that, Brother Steve? Well, I want you to back up to verse 1. Watch this. He says, blessed, which means happy, is that man who walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly. And we talked about that last week. Nor setteth on the seat of the scornful. We talked about that. Nor setteth, or standeth in the way of sinners, nor setteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he doth meditate day and night. That was a whole sermon. But here's the thing. How about God's blessings? How about his blessings? Do you know that when we have a spirit of thanksgiving within our lives, we need to be mindful of what he says in verse 3, then he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. What is he saying there? He's simply saying this. We need to be thankful that God is the one who has made his providential care for us. I really believe this as I look at life's journey. I see God's will upon all of our lives, and we look at providence. Providence is so important in our lives. I mean, I look at my life, and I see the providence of God as he's worked through my life. But you know, we as a nation, as we celebrate this Thanksgiving season, I want you to notice something. Do you know that not only does he say here that this individual shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, let's do a hermeneutical arch in relationship to our nation. Our great nation, Because I want to talk about Thanksgiving in relationship to the application within our own personal lives today. Do you know that I believe that this great nation was planted? I believe that. I really do believe that. What do you mean by that? It was planted on a national level, thankful to this nation, because this nation, my friend, was of a divine providence. Now, some people may look at me and say, no, I don't know about that. Let me tell you something. When our early forefathers came here, I believe it was a part of divine destiny that the United States would come into existence. And I'm going to talk about that probably here in a little bit later, okay, in the message. But we need to be thankful. I believe personally this is the greatest nation that's ever existed. I believe that. I really do. Now, some of you are probably saying, well, I know right now it doesn't look too good. We're in serious trouble. Yeah, because we let the heathens rule. Now, some of you may disagree with me and say, let the heathens rule. Yeah, the ungodly heathens are calling the shots today. Because what's right is right, and what's wrong is always wrong. And it's not, they're not blessing our nation, they're cursing our nation. Whatsoever a nation, whatsoever a people soweth, that shall they also reap. And we're going to reap some great tragedies in the day to come. You sow sin, you reap it. Sow righteousness, you reap it. And so what we've got to realize is this. This great nation was planted. It was a part of divine destiny. I think God was in it from the very, very start. Well, okay. Well, okay, that's the Thanksgiving part. Okay, how about the practical part in my life? I believe that when he says to this textual setting, he says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. Simply, he's simply saying that either as a nation or as individuals, we will be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. And what do you mean by that, Brother Steve? This is what's important. Not some wild tree that just grew up somewhere. He says that the man that walks, based upon verses 1 and verses 2, the man that walks after God's counsel and does not walk in the ways of the ungodly, but he lives his life, he says that he shall be like a tree planted. Doug, I believe this really makes application for you today. He says, oh God, where in the world is he going now with this, okay? Where is he going? You know, y'all, look, you can go out across a mountainside and you can see trees here and there. But it is distinctively different when you go to a man that's got the tree farm and he digs that tree. And when he digs it up, he doesn't dig it up because it's just come up wild somewhere. It was planted to start with, that it in itself might be transplanted for a purpose, a divine destiny. You see what I'm saying? See, what you don't realize is how many of you buy a house and just walk out in the yard and say, I want an oak tree to come up right here. I want a pine to come up over. I got to have my apple trees. No, there's decision making. There's an effort of planning. Wild trees just come up somewhere in a lot of places. But it says that you will be like one that is planted, which means that your life is planted by the caretaker. Personally planted. That's what he means by that. And we are purposefully planted, and we are, guess what? Strategically located. You're strategically located and planted for a purpose and in the right place. Let me tell you something. Doing landscaping and lawn work, you plant something in the wrong place, you can get in trouble. Especially when she comes out on the porch and she looks and she says, no, that's all wrong. Then you look at the guys working with you and say, I told you so. But that's all right. You gotta, look, listen. It's important that we realize that he is saying The purpose in the person who practices verses 1 and 2 is that they will be planted, strategically located by a personal caretaker with a purpose and with a destiny. All of that goes with it. Do you know so many people today don't see this? They don't. See, this is not in my message, but can I say something else? It's not in my message. But you know, I look back and I look at my life and what God did with me in Memphis and inner city and transformed my life, gave me a whole new destiny, a whole new life. Then he opened the doors for me to go to Union. Went to college at Union. They gave me an opportunity to speak at the BCM. And some old girl from Cookeville, Tennessee, happened to be at that BCM meeting. She became my sweetheart, okay? And later my wife, and the wife of my children. See, you look at divine destiny, and then you look at coming here and pastoring here now. Some 28 years as pastor came from. You look at things, and what you begin to see is that was a part of the caretaker. The caretaker. He was the one that planted me where I needed to be and said, look, son, this is what I want. This is my plan. You let me take care of it for you. And I'll have you in the right place at the right time. Doug, can I say something? Doug says, man, you quit using me in this sermon, okay? Go ahead, okay. I still remember 28 years ago, wasn't it? How that Doug was in charge of the pulpit committee those years. And I remember I was really reluctant about coming to Candy Fork. And I kind of backed off a little bit and said, Lord, I really want you to open the door, but until you just open the door wide open, I really don't want to walk through it, because this is a big transformation for us coming up here with three little bitty boys. Jesse's not born yet, and it's a big trick. God, I just really want your will for me to walk through. So I called Doug back, and I told Doug, I said, right now, I'm a little bit hesitant about this. I really just don't feel that full leadership in this, but I want to give y'all an open door to move on if you need to. I think that's fair, you know. Keep dingling, you know, hanging on, you know. He said, well, that's fair, Brother Steve. I said, okay. That next week was one of the most miserable weeks of my life. And I called Doug back. I said, Doug, can I talk with you? And he said, yeah. I said, something going on here. I said, this whole week, I said, just been miserable. I said, I feel like I made the wrong decision. I said, I feel like God's really leading us to Caney Fort Baptist Church. And I just really feel like we need to. And I said, I just wanted to call back and say, if that door's still open, I said, I think that's what we need to do. And he said, oh, yeah, he said, the door's still open. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said, we know that you're supposed to be the pastor of Caney Fort Baptist Church. And this whole week, after you said no, we didn't give up. We kept praying this whole week that God would show you what you needed to do. We went nowhere else. You're the man God wants for pastor of Caney Fort Baptist Church. Wow. Then I thought, now I know why my week has been what it's been. I said, no, we've looked nowhere else. Because you're the man that the whole committee said needs to be the pastor of Caney Fort Baptist Church. Let me tell you something, folks. When it comes to divine providence, you let God move and don't run from it. Amen? You stay with it. Divine providence is very important. And he'll plant you where he wants you to be. And when he plants you where he wants you to be, that's so, so important. In fulfilling divine destiny and to being able to say, thank you, Lord. Amen. But not only do we realize that we need to be thankful because of his providence that we see here, but secondly, might we be thankful because of God's provision, his provision. He says here, this is what he says, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water. That's divine destiny. That is his providence. And then he says, that bringeth forth its fruit in its season. That means this simply, that we need to be thankful for God's provision, for his bountiful blessings, not only individually, but as a nation. I'm going to bring the nation back into this, and on a personal level, I'm going to do it through this message. The thing that we've got to realize is this. We need to understand when he says here that he bringeth forth his fruit in its season, this nation has truly been a blessed, blessed nation. And as a nation in the area of agricultural aspects, raw materials, and other things, this nation is truly blessed. Think of any other nation in this world that has what we have. I don't know of any. All you have to do, y'all, is start in the Northeast and just think about steel industry up in this area. See, it takes all of us collectively putting this thing together. Okay? You got steels, and you come on down into the southern plains across here. You know, what do you have, y'all? You got agriculture. Listen to me. This great nation could not even survive if it wasn't for the southeast and the mid part of the United States in agriculture. Matter of fact, we feed the whole world, basically, just about. And then you move on across, and there's many different others. A lot of our fruits and stuff come from the West. So we collectively put together things as a great nation. We are bountifully blessed as a nation. May we never forget the contributions that we have in relationship to this great nation. Now, how about a personal level? Well, it says here this, that not only has he planted us individually by his divine providence, but secondly, we see his provision, and his provision is made known because he simply says this, he planteth us by the rivers of what? Water. He knew where to plant us, and he gives us the water that we need to be able to be sustained. He planteth us by the rivers of water. Do you know that a tree needs moisture and water to survive? It needs that. If not, it's going to dry up and it's going to die. And so what he's saying is this, that as a tree, he plants us where he wants us to be, and then he provides the moisture that's needed. Now, let me share something with you. When you realize that God's placed you where he wants to place you, and he is the sufficient one to supply you with life's journey and the needs that are there, you will begin to understand how it all then comes together. So important for us to understand that. Well, he plants us, and then he provides the water for us that we won't thirst to death because of his presence. His presence causes us to be able to persevere into the future. Yes, he plants us by divine providence, and then he makes provision for us that we're able to live and to make it through life's journey with his spiritual input into our lives. Do you know, as plants need water, we need the living water from heaven to make provision in our lives. We need that. I like what the writer of the book of Philippians has to say. Listen to what Paul says. He's talking about God and the provision that he makes in our lives. And he says this, but my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. As sure as the water is there for the tree, he is the living water for us And he shall supply all of our needs according to basically his riches that he has in heaven that he's going to impute into our lives. Wow. Man, God's provision is so, so important in our lives. He plants us, yes, because he loves us. He shows grace. He shows mercy. He shows his promises and he shows his presence. That's what he shows in our lives. Yes, truly, our God is a God that we need to be thankful for because of his providence and because of his provision. But listen to what else the psalmist has to say. We need to be thankful because of God's purpose. Listen to what he says. He says, not only will we be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, but here's his purpose. That bringeth forth its fruit in its season. There's the purpose. Wow. Providence? Yes, it's needed. Yes, provision, it's needed. But in the process of that, there's a purpose. That you and I will bring forth fruit in its season. Boy, that's good. When you and I begin to think about that. So, so important. He has a divine purpose. Now, let's jump back over the fence for a minute. Thanksgiving? Celebration? Yes. What do you mean by that, Brother Steve? Have you ever thought about this? Divine destiny into the United States from our forefathers and our colonists, the spirit of Thanksgiving, for the last 100 to 150 years, the greatest evangelistic nation in all the world has been the United States. There's no other place upon this earth that has done so well with the proclamation of the gospel and sending the gospel around the world. Think about that. Well, God had a providence for this nation. God made provision for this nation, and God has a purpose for this nation. And God, listen to me, God also has a providential will for your life, and God makes provision for your life, and he also has a purpose for your life as well. Tie all that together. Okay. What about the spreading of the gospel? Yes. I want you just to think about what this nation has meant to this world. Have you ever thought about this? When there's a major catastrophe, no matter where it is around the world, who shows up? It's the United States. We show up. I have to be nice for a moment. Can I be nice for a minute? Can I be nice for just a minute? Young people, you never forget what your pastor's telling you from this pulpit. This great nation called the United States saved all of Europe two times. Two times. We saved all of Europe in World War I, and we saved all of Europe in World War II, but you probably won't find that in your history books. Europe would have collapsed if it wasn't for this great nation called the United States of America. And there's a lot of other places all around this world that communism, dictatorship, would have destroyed them and taken them if it wasn't for this great nation. So I want to share with you something. Are you ready? God has a purpose for this nation. Amen. Think about that. And we need to have a spirit of thanksgiving for that. Wow. It's important that we realize that. When we begin to think about that and we begin to talk about that, yes, thanksgiving. We need to be thankful for his purpose for this great nation. But how about individually, though? Let's do that. What about us? How about individually? That we then may bring what? Forth fruit. That's what it says. All of that, he says, takes place that in the long run that we may bring forth fruit. And he saves us that we can be a part of what his divine plan is. That's important. Listen to what it says. He says, and he shall be like a tree planted. What is that? That's providence. By the rivers of water, that's provision, that bringeth forth his fruit in its season. And that is the purpose of planting us and watering us, is that we may bring forth fruit. Wow. That's the purpose. And he also says, in his season. Season. Timing is important. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'm going to lead to a little point, and you're going to say, man, Brother Steve, I got that. I got it. See, he says that the tree will be planted, it'll be watered, and it'll bring forth its fruit in its season. How many of you have ever planted an apple tree or a fruit tree, and you're constantly saying, I wonder when it's going to bear some apples? Just wonder when it's going to bear some apples. Or I just can't wait till the first peach I get off that tree. Takes time. And you know, here's something else. And it says it will come in its season. You know what's amazing is to go out and to be looking and not giving the apple tree time and taking that apple off the tree when it's not quite ready yet, and you're just so eager, and you bite into it and you say, it's just not that sweet. It's just going to take a little more time, but it's coming. How about a plum? Let me tell you something. You take a juicy plum off of a plum tree, and when you bite into it, man, the juice just wants to run out the side of your mouth. They're just juicy. Boy, they're good. But now, I'm going to tell you something. You take that plum off that plum tree early, and you'll bite into it like biting into a golf ball, okay? And you'll bite into it, and you'll say, man, that thing's not that good. Now, let's go to a way, way extreme. You get around a persimmon tree, buddy. You get a persimmon. I mean, I'm talking about one that's just yellow like a pumpkin and kind of got that deep, deep. They're sweet. They're actually sweet. But if you want to pucker up, bud, you grab that green one and bite into it. And y'all heard the story about what I did to my mother-in-law on purpose. Well, luckily, she didn't take a broom and beat me to death. I never forget, was out there on the farm one day, and I reached down. No, I looked up and picked one of them green persimmons. I said, hey, Mom. And she said, yes, Steve. I said, have you ever had a persimmon before? She said, no, I don't really, never really ate, you know, eating a persimmon. I said, here's one right here. And boy, I had it all set. It was green, 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 green. And I said, here, Mom, try one. And boy, she grabbed that green persimmon. She said, and buddy, she bit into it. And when she did, oh, Lordy, she threw it down and she puckered up. And, you know, she probably said, I'm going to kill that son-in-law of mine, okay? But she puckered up, her mouth just, ooh, okay. You know why, though, don't you? Because it wasn't what? In season yet. Do you know what? This just came to my thought. It's not even in my message. Some of us are still in the green persimmon stage. And God's working on us to bring us to a good tasting persimmon, okay? He's working on us, okay? So some of us are just not quite there yet, but you're coming. And I'm coming. And that's the application on that. It's simply this. Your season is coming. Your season is coming. It's coming. One who delights himself in the word of the Lord brings forth fruit at the right time. That's scripture. In that time. So you got to remember this. God's in the process of bringing us there. But you know what? It takes a while for that apple to get ripe. It takes a while for that plum to get ripe. It takes a while for that persimmon to get ripe. But it's coming. God's going to, I believe, can make you a great piece of fruit in the future that can be a contribution to somebody else's life. You can. And you know what else will happen? You won't wither away. Listen to what it says. It will bring forth its fruit in its season. And what? Its leaf shall not wither. It will not dry up, because faith will persevere in the day of trials. Amen? It will. We will have life. Life will have a lasting effect and peace in a moment of confusion. That's what we will have. You know what? You know one of the great ways that you can tell about a person's Christian faith? You know one of the ways you can tell about it? Is that when life begins to cave in and there's great tragedy in their lives, they're not like the leaf that has fallen and they dry up, they get hard, and you just crush them. That's one of the ways that you can find out about somebody's faith, is that their life, even in the moment of a trial situation, that their life does not wither and crumble. He says this, if you'll practice what is found in verses 1 and 2, he says that in the long run, you will not be like the leaf who withereth away. I want you to notice something else that's important here. We're going to basically, this last point is short, and it kind of really is the conclusion. Not only do we see his providence, not only do we see his provision, and not only do we see his purpose, but fourthly and lastly, might we be thankful for his favor. His favor. Yeah, watch what it says. He says, all of this, he shall be like a tree planted, providence, by the rivers of water, that is provision, bringeth forth its fruit in its what? Season, that's the purpose. And then he says, but what? And whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Amen. Wow. May we be thankful then for his result, or the result, which is his favor. I like having God's favor, don't you? I do, okay? So what we see is his favor. And he causes us to prosper. He shows favor. Now let me share something with you. Favor in general, in all of life. You got to be careful when you begin to tie together what favor is. And I'm going to tell you something. This modern day world, you're totally fooled about what's favor. Let me tell you something. Everybody thinks that favor is your job and what you have and how much money you can have and how big a house you can build. That doesn't mean favor. It doesn't mean favor if your children are going to hell in a handbasket. Oh, don't let me offend you. Listen to what I'm saying. That's not favor. Let me tell you something. Favor is when you can look at your whole life and you can see it in such a way that it has brought purpose, meaning, fulfillment in the journey. You need to be very careful about what you call favor. Let me tell you what. If you can lay down at night, close your eyes with a full stomach, you're favored. Amen? You're favored. Just because you have what you have doesn't mean that there's peace within. You remember that. Not everybody can have peace within. But you can if you'll let God be your peace. You can have peace within. So when we realize that and we begin to think about that, causes us to prosper. Let me share something with you. It's not even in my notes, but let me tell you something. I'm not a wealthy man. I don't have all kinds of money. I don't even have a big retirement built up where I've got, you know, hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars, and I don't have all the, you know, this and this. And, yeah, you know what I'm saying? But God's taking care of us, and He's blessed us. But you know what? I got three boys that I can call up at any time. Talk to them all the time. They'll call me, "Hey, Dad, how you doing?" I got three boys. I have a big bank account and all that kind of stuff. I may not be a big successful preacher in some big church. I don't have to have that. But I'll tell you what I got. I've got relationships that are very important. That's what I've got. It means a lot. And I'll tell you what. I got a wife that just loves me, loves me, loves me, and I don't understand what for. Okay? She just loves me and loves me and loves me. I don't know what for. Favor. I like that. That's a good one, man. Hey, baby, that's favor. Your favor on my life. That's called favor. There you go. That's good. That's precious, isn't it? I don't have to have all this. But, you know, when people look at my life and they'll say, "Well, Brother Steve, what would you say?" I would say, God has shown me favor. He has shown me favor. Favor is so, so important. God takes us in a very positive direction in the journey of life. So let's bring it together. Here it is. Watch this. May we be thankful that God is for us with His providence, with His provision, and with His purpose, ending in favor. It ends in favor, is how it ends, because of His providence, because of His provision, and because of His purpose. It ends in favor. A couple of questions. Do you really realize all that God has done for you? Wow. You know, yeah, we're in that season of thanksgiving. Have we really been thoughtful to think about and to realize all that God has done for us? Do you sense His presence? Do you sense that? I hope that you do. You remember this, God wants to work in your life. That's His desire. God wants you to know Him. He wants you to walk with Him and to be able to have fellowship with Him. Will you allow God to move in your life? Will you allow Him? I tell you what, if you do, you will begin to see His providence. You will begin to see His provision. And you'll discover His purpose for your life. You'll do that. Will you bow your heads, please?